أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين وحبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد. اللهم صل وسلم وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المكرمين الغرر الميامين، سيما بقية الله في الأراضين وحجته على الخلائق أجمعين، سيدنا وإمام زماننا وصاحب نعمتنا وولي أمرنا مهدي هذه الأمة وطاووس أهل الجنة الحجة ابن الحسن العسكري فداه أرواح العالمين. اللهم صل على محمد. Brothers and sisters, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Those who encountered Imam al-Hussein came in different shapes and sizes. They looked at life from different perspectives. Some were short-sighted, some were long-sighted, some had their priorities in the wrong place, whereas others submitted their existence to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is exactly why your beliefs matter, your creed matters, your aqaid matter. That is why it's critical that when deciding what to offer our children, what educational model to adopt, and what to teach and impart to the next generation, that we always prioritize what we call aqaid. If your belief in God is perverted, then your actions in life will always be crooked and messed up. There is no way one who lacks belief in God is going to stand and make the kinds of sacrifices that were made on the plains of Karbala on the day of Ashura. The single most defining feature in the camp of Imam al-Hussein was that they believed in God in an unconditional manner. Their belief in God was not hinging on anything else. It was the central, most pivotal object in their lives, and everything revolved around it. Every other priority, every other need, every other necessity was contingent upon their belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is why Allah If you notice, Imam al-Hussein and every other member of the Ahlul Bayt, this household is a household of belief and monotheism. The epitome, the manifestation, the embodiment of Tawheed is found in none other than the household of purity and infallibility, that of Muhammad and Al Muhammad salawatullahi alayhi wa sallam. And so if you hold on to this household, if you try and emulate them and walk in their footsteps and take them as role models, you will also be one who epitomizes and embodies Tawheed in its purest form, which is why Imam al-Sadiq was speaking about the role of the Imam, the position of the divinely appointed leader, and the concept of Imamah. And it's then that he said, Ilaha hunat Tawheed. Tawheed extends to the concept of Imamah. Without Imamah, there is no Tawheed. Become allaman Allahu ma'alim deenina, as we recite in Ziyarat al-Jami' al-Kabira. Without the Imams, there is no belief in God. What there is some abstract notions that are perverted beyond recognition. What there is different conceptualizations of God, which are ultimately not notions that will define your life the way belief in God defined the companions of Imam al-Husayn. In one hadith, Imam al-Husayn explains the central difference between him and his household and the Imams of the Ahlul Bayt and their followers with Bani Umayyah and their followers. Their followers who extend to this day and age, right? That is why we curse them in Ziyarat Ashura. We curse Bani Umayyah and their followers to this very day. The Imam explains, he says, قَالُوا كَذَبَ اللَّهُ وَقُلْنَا صَدَقَ اللَّهُ. Their belief centered on the notion that God doesn't exist. Which is why in one of the ziyarat of Imam al-Husayn, we address the Imam as being the one who جاهد الملحدين. It was disbelief in God that brought about the massacre of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn. It was the idea that God does not exist, that there is no afterlife, that there is no reckoning, that there is no reward, there is no punishment, there is no remuneration of any kind, that created a person like Yazid and Ibn Ziyad and Umar ibn Sa'd and others. And so when looking at the people who encountered Imam al-Husayn, you see this major and stark disparity in their beliefs. For example, you'll find the ones who abandoned Imam al-Husayn. The ones who might have actually liked the Imam. They didn't have a problem with the Imam per se. Like the people of Medina, for example. Just think about this. I've always found it deeply disturbing that the people of Medina would see Imam al-Husayn pick up his family and take them out of the city in the pitch black darkness of night without them batting an eye. The people of Medina didn't even ask, where are you going, Ya Abu Abdullah? What is going on? Can we help you? Imagine if you had a marja, for example, in this city of yours, who suddenly decided to pack his bags and leave, at night, no less, without any forewarning, without any preparation, without any succession plan, just gets up and leaves. Shouldn't people ask why? Shouldn't they extend a helping hand? Shouldn't they approach this marja? Now imagine, this isn't just a marja. This is Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, Sayyidu Shababi Ahlil Jannah, Sibtu Rasulillah, wa rayhanatuhu min ad-dunya. The most beloved person to Rasulullah at that time was Imam al-Husayn. He gets up and leaves and no one even bats an eye. No one even asks, bothers enough to ask, is there something I can do for you, Ya Aba Abdullah? Now I'm not saying that they deserved it, but that's what you get. When you abandon Imam al-Husayn the way they did, it was only a matter of 2 years. 2 years. When Musrif came as the head of an army, and they ransacked the city of Medina, violating every conceivable sanctity, killing 1,000 companions of Rasulullah along the way, as they pillage through the city of the Prophet. That's what you get when you don't make a stance because you're afraid, because you're looking after your own interests and your own priorities, and you forsake and abandon God and those who represent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's one example. Then you have people who joined the Imam at first, but then snuck out in the middle of the night, as they did on the 5th and the sixth of the month of Muharram, right? Fatima al-Kubra says that I could see people leaving two at a time, three at a time, four at a time. When they began to sense that this mission was not going to end the way they had anticipated, they thought this was going to be a victory lapse. They thought this was Imam al-Husayn entering the city of Kufa as the savior who was going to single-handedly and miraculously remove Yazid from power and replace him with a just and righteous ruler, only to realize that no, هذا طريق ذات الشوكة, This road is a thorny one. This road is an arduous and rocky one. There's going to be tests and trials and hardships. There's going to be thirst, and there's going to be loneliness, and there's going to be bloodshed, and there's going to be death by the river Euphrates. And so when they began to realize that, when specifically when news of the savage and barbaric murder of Muslim ibn Aqil reached the camp of Imam al-Husayn, they began to fled. So there is that type as well. Then you have people who stayed with Imam al-Husayn until the day of Ashura, and I spoke about al-Dhahhak al-Mashriqi, if you remember in the previous nights, who was with Imam al-Husayn until the afternoon of Ashura, until the first ambush ended. Remember the first ambush, where the dust settled only to see 50 of Imam al-Husayn's companions had been massacred and butchered like sacrificial lambs. He was still there. He saw all of this. And yet, he abandoned Imam al-Husayn. Then you have people who joined the Imam on the day of Ashura. People like Hur, people like Ali ibn al-Hur, the son of Hur, people like the slave of Hur. When Hur joined, he inspired others to follow in his footsteps. And the story is actually quite beautiful, because remember how Hur decided to leave his camp and switch sides over to Imam al-Husayn's camp. He simply started to drift away, one step at a time, taking it very slowly, taking into consideration the fact that this was a very sensitive moment. If they realized that the leader of one of the main contingents of the army was going to switch sides, then there would be a great deal happening in response. So he began to drift away one step at a time. There was one who was standing next to him who said that, "I assumed Hur was going to go and relieve himself behind a tree, so I didn't look at him, only to see Hur going towards the camp of Imam al-Husayn and saying, 'Ya Aba Abdullah, hal li min tawbah?' Is there a chance for me to repent? Is there a way back for me, having committed the crimes that I have?" When that happened, his son, some say his brother, was still in the army of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, the army of Yazid. So now that Hur had switched sides, he couldn't utilize the same means. He couldn't trick them into switching sides. So he had to get more creative. So what he did was, at the spur of the moment, he said, "What has Hur done to our family? He has dishonored my tribe. Let me go and kill him. Let me go and avenge the dishonoring of my tribe from my brother." And so they let him go. He runs towards his brother. Instead of striking him with the sword, he embraces him and he joins him. Then there is the slave of Hur. And the slave of Hur was left without any options. He couldn't trick his camp, and so instead all he did was he pulled out his sword. He began to fight the people immediately around him until he was outnumbered and killed. You have this kind of people. Then you have the people who abandoned Imam al-Husayn halfway through, and the ones who abandoned him towards the end. And then you have the people who were preparing for Imam al-Husayn for a very, very long time. You see, there is a reason why Habib ibn Mudahhar is so special, brothers and sisters. There is a reason why Habib ibn Mudahhar has his own separate shrine in Karbala. Of all the companions of Imam al-Husayn, of course, they're all stars in the galaxy of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. They're all leaders and role models for humanity from the time of Imam al-Husayn until the Day of Judgment. They are all going to be raised as supporters of Imam al-Mahdi when he reappears, inshallah, to cleanse the earth of oppression and replace it with justice and equity. But even among them, there are different levels. And Habib ibn Mudahhar stands out. Every time I visit the shrine of Imam al-Husayn, on the way out, you also encounter the smaller, less assuming, but most definitely overwhelming shrine of Habib ibn Mudahir. And I, along with millions of people, hold on to that shrine and say, you are the guardian of the gate of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn. You are the archetypal slave and submissive servant of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn. It's like Habib ibn Mudahir is standing there taking guard duty. He's the doorman to the king of the universe. And so I ask him to intercede for me so that Abu Abdullah al-Husayn might also look at me and make me one of his slaves. There's a difference between Habib ibn Mudahir and other companions. Let me share a story with you that is truly inspiring. Ibn Sa'd, not Umar ibn Sa'd, but Ibn Sa'd al-Haythami, I think his name is one of the famous Sunni historians, and he has written a book called At-Tabaqat al-Kubra. This book basically talks about the different levels of companionship to the Prophet, starting with the companions, then the tabi'een, and so on and so forth. So it's a biographical account of the lives of the companions of the Prophet. And because of that, and while he has to look at the lives of the companions, he also takes a look at the major historical turning points in Islam. He mentions a tradition in his book. He says that there was a man by the name Al-Uryan ibn al-Haytham. Uryan ibn al-Haytham narrates, he says, my father and I used to go out in the desert. Every once in a while we'd go out, whether it be for hunting or just on vacation, but we used to go out quite frequently. And one of the places we used to go to was called At-Taf, or Nainawa, or as we know it today, Karbala. This is in the time of Amir al-Mu'mineen, or perhaps later in the time of Imam al-Hasan. He says, we used to go out there, and there was always this one man who was roaming that space, and just, it looked as though he always lived there, or he frequented that area a lot. And so one day my father asked him, he said, what are you doing here? Every time we come here, we see you. He said, well, I've heard a tradition that one day Al-Husayn ibn Ali will be faced by an army of 30,000 people on this land. I am waiting for that day to come so that I may join him and defend him. Al-Uryan ibn al-Haytham says, many years passed until one day we received the news, يَا أَهْلَ يَثْرِبَ لَا مُقَامَ لَكُمْ بِهَا قُتِلَ الْحُسَيْنُ فَأَدْمُعِي مِدْرَارُ الْجِسْمُ مِنْهُ بِكَرْبَلَاءَ مُضَرَّجٌ وَالرَّأْسُ مِنْهُ عَلَى الرِّمَاحِ مُشَالُ Imam al-Husayn has been killed. He said, my father said to me, quick, let's go to the site of the massacre. We hurried towards Karbala and we saw the butchered bodies of Imam al-Husayn and his companions, as well as the enemy soldiers. So my father said, let's go and find that man that we used to see, who's from the tribe of Bani Asad, Al-Asadi, he calls him. So let's go and see if we can find him. Eventually we saw his body among the companions of Imam al-Husayn. There's a big difference between one who says, you know what, let's wait for Imam al-Zaman to come and then we'll see what happens, and one who actively prepares for the arrival of the Imam, one who anticipates the Imam. You know how they say that it's people who are successful in business are the ones that are not reactionaries. They're not the ones that wait until there's a trend in the market and only then do they step in and try and invest, right? The ones who are truly successful, the ones that are visionaries, the ones that end up becoming the A-listers of the business world, essentially, are the ones that can anticipate change even before it happens. They're the ones that can see an opportunity and seize that opportunity. They're the ones who hear a rumor somewhere and use their business acumen. Obviously, they have to do their due diligence. They have to understand all the risks involved. But in the end, they're bold enough to make the investment before it becomes fashionable, before it becomes a trending topic on Twitter and Facebook. They're the ones who are the most successful. And the most successful in this religion, brothers and sisters, are the ones who anticipate change before it happens. They're the ones who use the teachings and the prophecies of the messengers of Allah and the imams of the Ahlul Bayt in order to shape their lives in such a way so that in the end, they're ready when the time comes. They're ready. There's a verse in the Quran that talks about this phenomenon, and it's in a way really quite scary. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do they not see يَوْمَ يَأْتِي مَلَائِكَةُ رَبِّكَ, when the angels of your Lord come, or when your Lord comes, أَوْ تَأْتِي بَعْضُ آيَاتِ رَبِّكَ, or some of your Lord's signs will come. Now, subhanallah, how many verses in the Quran can be directly related back to Imam al-Zaman, right? Before I go back to this verse, there's another verse that comes to mind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says that there's going to be a day, right? وَأَشْرَقَتِ الْأَرْضُ بِنُورِ رَبِّهَا, the earth will be filled with light and will shine with the light of its Lord. Right? And so some people interpret this verse by saying that this applies to paradise. In paradise, the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the form of some kind of a light source, whether it be a star or something else, will shine upon the heaven. And that explains the verse, because to say that this would take place on earth doesn't quite make sense, that the entire earth will be illuminated with the light of the Lord, not just one side of it with the sun. But that doesn't make any sense, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says in the Quran about paradise, in describing paradise, he says, لا يرون فيها شمسا ولا زمهريرا. There is no sun in paradise. There's no sun there. Where the light comes from, I will leave it up to you to guess. The light will come from the uppermost level in paradise, where Muhammad and Ali and Fatima and Hassan and Hussein reside. It is the smile of Fatima al-Zahra, the whiteness of her teeth, the beauty of Hassan, the illumination of Hussein, that will illuminate paradise. And so traditions tell us, وَأَشْرَقَتِ الْأَرْضُ بِنُورِ رَبِّهَا, this nur, this light, is the light of Imam al-Zaman. And it's his light that shall illuminate the earth in such a way that people will become self-sufficient. يَسْتَغْنُونَ بِنُورِهِ عَنْ نُورِ الشَّمْسِ, his light will penetrate every building and will enter every house such that people will no longer need the light of the sun. Nur Ali Muhammad, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. And so, let's go back to that verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when the signs of your Lord, when some of your Lord's signs shall come, or when your Lord shall come. Obviously, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't occupy any physical space. It makes no sense to say that God would come and go and rise up or down. Clearly, this verse isn't talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he's talking about another Lord. He's talking about the Lord appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Lord meaning the one who has lordship and authority over us. أَلَسْتُ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ قَالُوا اللَّهُمَّ بَلَىٰ. Does the Prophet not have full authority over us? Authority that is vested in him from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, by God you do. قَالَ مَنْ كُنْتُ مَوْلَاهُ فَهَذَا عَلِيٌّ مَوْلَاهُ. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in that verse, when that happens, when your Lord comes, or signs of your Lord come, or the angels of your Lord come, لَا يَنْفَعُ نَفْسٌ إِيمَانُهَا لَمْ تَكُنْ آمَنَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَوْ كَسَبَتْ فِي إِيمَانِهَا خَيْرًا. When that happens, if you did not already possess belief and faith, then it's too late. If you don't already have enough certainty in your heart to follow the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and recognize the signs of your Lord, then it's already too late. It's like Fir'aun when he became a believer at the last minute. He was still alive. He wasn't technically dead yet. He was drowning in the Nile when he said, "Amantu bi Rabbi Musa wa Harun." Now I believe. The response was, "Al-an." Now you believe, it's too late. You were always a disbeliever. You always rejected every sign that was given to you, that was shown to you. Now you decide to believe when you've seen death staring at you and clinching its proverbial claws into your soul to extract it and throw it in the fires of hell to burn for eternity in the inferno. It's too late. It's too late. So this verse, in a way, is rather deeply concerning. It basically says that if you're not already prepared for the Imam when he comes, if you're not already anticipating his return, when it happens, you won't recognize it even if it hits you in the face. Or you will reject it despite all the evidence, despite all the proofs that he will come with. And that is the crux of our problem, brothers and sisters. The problem in the community of believers. We're not even talking about the ones who abandoned Imam al-Hussein, the ones who decided to confront Imam al-Hussein, the ones who actively pursued his murder and shed his innocent blood. We're not talking about those. We're talking about the ones who actually proclaim love of the Ahlul Bayt. In other words, people like you and I. We know for a fact that we have the love in our hearts. But we also need to diagnose the potential pitfalls, the potential ailments and risks involved and present on our path toward the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of them is this. Listen carefully. It's the fact that we often have a tendency where we know where the truth lies and we love the Ahlul Bayt and we'd like to follow them, but we would also like to live a life of comfort and peace and happiness and joy and endless uninterrupted pleasure in this world as well. Meaning that we'd like to have it both ways. We want to have both a life of spirituality but also immense and unlimited financial prosperity. Right? It's like saying, and I know I've been talking about this and I've been causing quite a stir over the last couple of nights, about the importance of having bigger families, right? Of increasing capacity within the family structure of the community of the lovers and believers in the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. And what's important to note as well is that oftentimes I will get this question, well, how can we have 6 or 7 or 8 or 12 children, the ideal number being 12, by the way, if you haven't picked up on the hint. How can we possibly have 12 children while also having a double income family where both the wife and husband will pursue their education, get their PhDs, get a high flying career in Wall Street? Well, of course you can't have it both ways. What I'm saying is, let's temper our expectations a little bit. Let's have a little contentment in our lives. You want to be a millionaire by the age of 25, but also have 5 kids, but also go to be the first person to enter paradise, but also be one of the 313? It doesn't work that way. Wake up and smell the coffee, as they say. You have to temper your ambitions. Nobody's saying you shouldn't be ambitious. But the reality of it is that if, and again, this is really, if you're going to boil down and summarize this entire talk, it's in this statement. If the push comes to the shove, and you find yourself having to choose between your religious ideals, your values, your principles, your belief in God, your fellowship of the Ahlul Bayt, and a comfortable life of pleasure and fun, then you should know which to pick. Right? The problem is that we want it both ways. We like to keep our options open, don't we? It's like, okay, I'll be a believer. I'll try and do the best, you know, I can. I'll try and raise a good family. But if there was ever a conflict, right, we kind of just stall. And we try and find out if there is any tricks or anything I can do to kind of just, again, have it both ways. Keep our options open. It doesn't work that way. It might work sometimes, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, here's the trick, here's the difference between a life of virtue of one who follows in the footsteps of the prophets and the imams and one who doesn't. The one who doesn't might end up becoming a millionaire, maybe even a billionaire, but there's no contentment. There's really no satisfaction at the end of the day. There is no comfort, there is no peace, and I've talked about this before. Whereas the life of one who is content with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him, what tends to happen is that, as Imam al-Sadiq says in one hadith, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Remember the verse that I recited a few nights ago, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مَنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. Whoever guards themselves against sin, God will find a way out for them and provide for them from sources they did not anticipate or expect. And whoever relies on Allah, Allah will be sufficient for him. Imam al-Sadiq says in a hadith that this providence from sources that you didn't expect, this sustenance from sources that you didn't anticipate, is in the form of يُبَارِكْ لَهُ فِي مَا أَعْطَى. Allah will bless you in whatever He has given you. In other words, it may not be a lot, but you will feel content and blessed and happy. You may not have the most expensive cars or the most luxurious clothes or the biggest homes, but you will feel happy. And isn't that all it's about? Isn't that what everybody's trying to pursue when they run after money and work and career and education and all that? Is to do what at the end? It's to settle down and be happy. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you know what? You can be happy right from now. You don't have to enter the rat race. You don't have to go into that crazy dog-eat-dog world of business and whatever. You can be happy right now, alhamdulillah, with whatever you have. He'll give you a few children who are good and pious and loving and caring, who will look after you and not abandon you in your old age. He will give you siblings and brothers and parents and family members and friends who care about you. He will give you a house that is enough for you. You know what I mean? That is the difference between a believer and one who is not a believer. At the end of the day, we both live our lives. We both enjoy our lives. We both go through ups and downs. We both have pain as well as pleasure. And at the end of it all, we will all die. As Imam al-Sadiq said to Ibn Abi al-Hawja, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala alihi. Abdul Karim Ibn Abi al-Hawja, the Imam said to him, who was a staunch atheist and one who would enter into these endless debates with the sixth Imam but never be content with or satisfied with any of his answers, right? He was a staunch, arrogant, ignorant, but also rather smart, in the sense that most of the arguments that we hear today from people like Sam Harris, Christopher Hitchens, Richard Dawkins, and other high priests of the atheist church, as they call them, all the arguments that we hear from them, there's really nothing new in them. If you've read the debates between Imam al-Ridha and the atheists and the disbelievers and the materialists, and if you hear the debates between our sixth Imam and Abdul Karim ibn Abi al-Awja and others, you'll find that it's the same old arguments, except that they're repackaged and slapped with a new label to accommodate the 21st century. There's like a few examples from biology, from cosmology, from here and there, but in the end, it's the same old sorry, pathetic arguments that can easily be debunked and easily be refuted even by a six-year-old. أَبِنَايْتٌ مِنْ دُونِ بَانٍ. The Imam says, is there a building without a builder? أَجِنَايَةٌ مِنْ غَيْرِ جَانٍ. Is there a crime without a criminal? Is there a murder without a murderer? And yet the whole universe doesn't have a creator? A simple building, a shed that didn't exist 2 weeks ago, you drive past this road and then you see there's a new shed. What are you going to assume? That it just came about by itself? That it's the product of chance? That it's the singularity that brought into existence? The first thing you're going to ask is, who built this here? If you saw a little wood chunk, for example, out by the door, what are you going to say? Who put this here? Who put it here? You're not going to say it just came about, or it evolved into existence. It's the same old arguments, pathetic and meaningless and easily refutable, but the repackaged, as I said. So Imam al-Sadiq says to Ibn Abi al-Awja, he says to him, إِن كَانَ الْأَمْرُ كَمَا تَقُولُ. By the way, this argument is now called Pascal's wager. So it's attributed to a French philosopher by the name of Pascal, but this is actually something that is attributed to Imam al-Sadiq many years before Pascal. The Imam said, if it turns out that there is no God, there is no afterlife, there is no heaven, there is no hell, which that's not the case, by the way. إِن كَانَ الْأَمْرُ كَمَا تَقُولُ وَلَيْسَ كَمَا تَقُولُ. فُزْنَا وَفُسْتْ. We're both winners. Because we both lived. We both got married. We both had kids. We both had jobs. We both earned money. We both ate. We both drank. We both lived our lives and died. So what's the difference between you and me and them? Why are you preaching the non-existence of God? Right? Why are you an evangelist for lack of a creator? Why are you wasting your time? وَإِن كَانَ الْأَمْرُ كَمَا نَقُولُ وَهُوَ كَمَا نَقُولُ. But if what we say is true, and it is true, if there is a God, if there is a creator, if there is reckoning, if there is accountability, if there is heaven, if there is hell, فُزْنَا وَهَلَكْتْ, then we win and you lose. So our problem, and the problem of most believers, as I said, most lovers of Imam al-Hussein, as this initial period of mourning comes to a close, it's important that we reflect on the potential pitfalls that may obstruct our path towards Abu Abdullah al-Hussein. Having made the commitment to board his ark as we did on night one, having made the solemn vow that we will follow in his footsteps and do as he, live as he lived. Allahumma ahyini hayata Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad wa amitni mamata Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad wa la tufarriq bayni wa baynahum tarfata 'aynin abada. Let me live the life of the Prophet and his family. Let me die the death of the Prophet and his family. And never separate me from them even for a blink of an eye. If that is the commitment that we've made, then let's try and diagnose the potential problems that may hinder our path. And that problem that I'd like to focus on and wrap up, inshallah, tonight's talk is the fact that we often try to have it both ways, but that doesn't work out. It really doesn't. At some point, you're going to have to make a decision. At some point, you're going to have to put your foot down and say, you know what? I will take Hussein's path and not that of Yazid. I am no one to be analyzing or objecting to someone as great and glorious as Al-Hur. But in order for us to diagnose the problem so that we don't fall into it, look at what Hur's problem was. Hur wanted to have it both ways. Hur was told, Imam al-Hussein told him, that it's time for prayer when he first obstructed the Imam's path. The Imam said to him, it's time for prayer. How about you lead your troops in prayer and I lead my camp? He said, no, Ya Aba Abdullah, Nusalli bi salatik. We will all pray behind you. So he's the kind of person who wants to pray behind Imam al-Hussein, but he has no qualms or no problems with blocking Imam al-Hussein's passageway toward his final destination. It doesn't work that way. You can't have it both ways. You can't keep your options open. And until the moments prior to the beginning of the battle of Ashura, again, Hur wanted to have it both ways. I want to be the chief of my tribe. I want to be the commander of this army. I want to be close to the political establishment and the ruler. I want to have a good, comfortable life, while at the same time, Hussein is on the other side. He is completely surrounded. He's getting killed. So that thought process, the struggle between the two options that are now so contradictory, you cannot have them both at the same time, comes to a culmination and a physical manifestation when Hur begins to shake. He starts to shake. His friend says to him, I didn't think of you as someone who would shake and fear and tremble. If anybody had asked me who's the most courageous person in Kufa, lama adawtuk, I would never miss mentioning you. Why am I seeing you shaking? He said, it's not that. It's the fact that now that journey, those conflicts, those contradictions between pleasure in this world and the afterlife and our ideals and principles is now coming to a point where the tension is too strong to ignore. I can't keep telling myself that I can have it both ways. I can't keep telling myself that, you know what, I can be comfortable, but also I'll end up in paradise as well. I can't, the tension is too strong. إِنَّمَا أَرَى نَفْسِي بَيْنَ الْجَنَّةِ وَالنَّارِ I see myself between heaven and hell. It's time to choose. And he chose right. Good for him. Imam al-Hussein was the one who saved him. You know, isn't it amazing that on the eve of Ashura, Imam al-Hussein told all of his companions to pack their bags and leave. He said, I relieve you of any commitment or vow or oath of allegiance that you made to me. You're relieved of all that. And the Imam, by the way, wasn't, you know, he wasn't playing any tricks. He wasn't trying to test them. It was a genuine offer of, you know what, you can leave if you want. And yet on the next day, the day of Ashura, Imam al-Hussein was doing the opposite. He kept calling out, Ala hal min nasirin yansuruna li wajhi Allah. Is there no one to come and help us? Why? What changed? What happened? Do you know what happened? On the eve of Ashura, Imam al-Hussein wanted to purify his camp. He told them to leave lest there be one who was there but didn't deserve to be there. He's filtering them, he's cleansing them, he's purifying them. On the day of Ashura, Imam al-Hussein is asking for help lest there be one worth saving in the camp of Umar ibn Sa'd. That's how merciful Abu Abdullah al-Hussein is. Maybe there is someone, which is one of the reasons why Imam al-Hussein even took his six-month-old infant and presented him to the enemy. Because if you're not going to show mercy, إِلَّمْ تَرْحَمُونِي فَرْحَمُوا هَذَا الصَّغِيرُ If you're not going to show mercy to an adult, to a grown man, to someone like Hussein and Abbas and Qasim, then maybe there is one in this camp who's going to show some mercy and exhibit some kind of compassion toward a six-month-old infant. You know the special thing for those of you who have had children or who have had small siblings is that when a baby is first born, he's too frail and fragile, too small. But it's only around the age of 6 months that now the child is taking shape. He has more strength. He is so beautiful. Maybe there is someone who's going to look at this young child and he's going to find his own salvation. The musibah of Abdullah al-Radi' Aliyun al-Asghar was so painful, brothers and sisters. I don't know why I ended up here. I didn't intend on mentioning this musibah. But the musibah was so painful that after the battle had ended, Sakina says, and Allama al-Majlisi narrates this incident in Bihar al-Anwar. It's a reliable, authentic source. He says that Sakina came in the middle of the night looking for her father. But when she wasn't able to locate his sacred body, suddenly she heard a voice that resembled that of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. Imam al-Husayn started eulogizing himself, reading his own masa'ib. What did he say? He said, Shi'ati mahma sharibtum adhab ma'in fadhkuruni. O my followers, O Shi'a of Aba Abdullah, this is a message to all of us from the Imam himself. Shi'ati mahma sharib tum adhab ma'in fadhkuruni. Whenever you drink fresh water, remember Hussein, Hussein, Hussein. أو سمعتم بقتيل أو غريب فاندبوني. If you ever hear of someone who was killed while lonely, remember Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. فَأَنَا السَّبْطُ الَّذِي مِنْ غَيْرِ جُرْمٍ قَتَلُونِي. For I am the grandson of Rasulullah, who was killed without a crime. Innocent, pure Hussein. And I wish that was all they did. Once again, the words of the Imam. وبجارد الخيل بعد القتل ظلما سحقوني. After Aba Abdullah was killed, Umar ibn Sa'd said, bring me 10 horses. They brought 10 horses. He saw those horses. He said, these horses are too tired. I want fresh horses. They brought another set of horses. He looked at them. He said, no, their shoes are worn out. I want their shoes to be sharp. Then he ordered the horses to trample on the body of Aba Abdullah. أيوة فاطمة وعليا ومحمدا. They say that while Imam Zain al-Abidin was inside the tent, they suddenly heard the sound of glass being shattered. Those were the ribs of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. Everyone call out, Hussein.
حزين حزين. So Aba Abdullah says to his daughter Sakina, not only did they kill me, but tell my Shia that they used their horses to trample on my chest. The chest of Aba Abdullah and his ribs had to be broken just like his mother Fatima Zahra. If those ribs had not been broken on the day of Saqifa, then the ribs of her son Hussein would not be shattered on Ashura. But then Aba Abdullah, of all the tragedies that he witnessed, he wants to remind the Shia of one particular musiba. He tells them, "Laytakum, I wish you were there, my Shia, my followers. I wish you were there witnessing كيف أستسقي لطفلي فأبو. I was begging them for water for my six-month-old infant. Ah, Hussein, Hussein." Sakina hears these words from her father, Zainab. I mentioned to you what Zainab did with Aba Abdullah on that night. But perhaps the most painful scene in that night, after everyone had gone to bed, everyone, it's not that they slept, it's that they all fell unconscious. Allah, Allah, the most painful scene was when Zainab hears there is a woman out there searching through the body. Who is that? Is that an enemy soldier? No, Zainab, this is Rubab. I have drank water and now there is milk in my breast. Bunayya Ali, my son Ali Azhar. A mother who loses her child has no sleep anymore. They have no life. Their lives are gone as far as they're concerned. Have you ever seen a grieving mother? Allahu Akbar. Now this is a grieving mother looking for her child who was thirsty and was taken to be fed by the enemy. And he never came back. She never saw Ali Asghar after that. How could she see him? There's a man by the name of Abu Ayyub. Allahu Akbar, I'll say this and wrap up. Abu Ayyub was captured by Al-Mukhtar al-Thaqafi. Al-Mukhtar captured this man. He said to him, "You see that boiling pot of lead? I'm going to burn you on that." He said, "But I didn't do anything. It wasn't my fault. It was Umar bin Sa'd's fault. I didn't do anything." He said, "Well, tell me exactly what you did." He said, "Well, Umar ibn Sa'd, when we were about to leave, he said that every tribe, if you are going to receive a prize, then every tribe needs to bring a head along with them. But all the heads were taken. So I said to them, I saw Hussein go to the back of his tent and dig up a small grave with the tip of his sword. And I saw him bury his six-month-old infant in that grave. My tribe went toward that location. They started stabbing the ground with their spears. Aywa Husayna wa mazluma." Imagine what Rabab has to go through seeing the severed head of her 6-month-old infant on the spear from Karbala to Kufa and from Kufa to Sham. But what truly killed Rabab wasn't even the head of Ali al-Asghar. It was seeing the head of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein being beaten by Yazid. She jumped and held the head of Aba Abdullah. بأبي أنت وأمي يا أبا عبد الله لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين إلهنا إنا نسألك وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله 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 يا الله. Your eyes are tearful, your hearts are broken. This is the moment when Fatima al-Zahra answers your prayers. Fatima al-Zahra says, these people came to mourn my son Hussein. Now is the time to be compensated by Bibi. This is the time to pray. What is our most important prayer? Allahumma ajjil li waliyika al-faraj, ya Allah. Allahumma kul li waliyika al-hujjat ibn al-Hasan salawatuka alayhi wa ala abaihi fi hadhihi as-sa'a wa fi kulli sa'a وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا. اللهم وارزقنا رأفته ورحمته وعونه ودعاءه وخيره ما ننال به سعة من رحمتك وفوزا عندك يا أرحم الراحمين. Oh Allah, never separate us from Hussein. Oh Allah, help us follow in his footsteps. Oh Allah, join us with him and his companions in paradise. Oh Allah, grant us his ziyarah in this world, year after year, until the day we die in Karbala and on our way to ziyarah. Oh Allah, protect our ulama, our maraji'. Oh Allah, keep us on the path of the Ahlul Bayt, as well as our families and our children, and especially our youth, in the name of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات ومن مات على ولاية أمير المؤمنين وخدمة أبي عبد الله الحسين والشهداء والصالحين نهدي لهم ثواب مجلسنا هذا وثواب سورة المباركة الفاتحة مع الصلوات.
Hussein, 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 Hussein,
can you hear it loud and the call of Sayyid al-Shuhada, هل من ناصر ينصرنا هل من ناصر ينصرنا Can you hear it loud and clear The call of Sayyid al-Shuhada هل من ناصر ينصرنا هل من ناصر ينصرنا On that day of Ashura From that land of Karbala هل من ناصر ينصرنا هل من ناصر ينصرنا On that day of Ashura From that land of Karbala هل من ناصر ينصرنا هل من ناصر ينصرنا Can you hear it loud and clear The call of Sayyid al-Shuhada هل من ناصر ينصرنا هل من ناصر ينصرنا On that day of Ashura From that land of Karbala هل من ناصر ينصرنا هل من ناصر ينصرنا Battered and surrounded by the likes of Shimro Hurmala هل من ناصر ينصرنا هل من ناصر ينصرنا Hurt and thirsty at his cry reaches everyone near and far هل من ناصر ينصرنا 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 There is no قاسم no أكبر أو no محمد عبد الله There is no Abbas or no Muslim Ibn Osija. There is no Qasim, no Akbar, or no Muhammad Abdullah. There is no Abbas or
no Muslim Ibn Osija.
Hal min Nasir yansurna, hal min Nasir yansurna. هل من ناصر ينصرنا هل من ناصر ينصرنا We wish we were there to say لبيك يا ابن رسول الله We wish we could have responded to your call of Ashura We wish we were there to say لبيك يا ابن رسول الله We wish we could have responded to your call of Ashura Hal min Nasir yansurna Hal min Nasir yansurna Hal min Nasir yansurna Hal min Nasir yansurna 1400 years it's been Still it feels like yesterday Your Hal min still resonates In the minds of your Shia Hal min Nasir yansurna Hal min Nasir yansurna Hal min Nasir yansurna
Hal min Nasir yansurna
We will be your messengers We will propagate your name We will spread the light of justice through the power of your flame. We will be your messengers. We will propagate your name. We will spread the light of justice through the power of your flame. But if we want to be this way, if we wish to say labbaik, we must first begin to see we must first begin to take. If we want to be this way, if we wish to sail a beg, we must first begin to see. We must first begin to take. Every day as Ashura, every land as Karbala, Kullo Yawmin Ashura, Kullo Ardin Karbala. Every day as Ashura, every land as Karbala, Kullo Yawmin Ashura, Kullo Ardin Karbala. Hal Min Nasir Yansuruna, Hal Min Nasir Yansuruna, Hal Min Nasir Yansuruna. Everyone, Hal Min Nasir Yansuruna, Hal Min Nasir Yansuruna, Hal Min Nasir Yansuruna, Hal Min Nasir Yansuruna. Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein,
Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Allahumma salli ala
السلام عليك يا رسول الله السلام عليك يا نبي الله السلام عليك يا أمير المؤمنين ويا سيدا وسيم السلام عليك يا فاطمة الزهراء ويا سيدتا نساء العالمين السلام عليك يا خديجة الكبرى السلام عليك يا حسن المجتبى الناصح الأمين السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله الحسين وعلى تسعة المعصومين من ذريتك السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك يا غريب الغرباء السلام عليك يا معين الضعفاء والفقراء السلام عليك يا شمس الشموس ويا أنيس النفوس أيها المدفون بأرض توس يا علي بن موسى أيها الرضا كن شفيعي وشفيعا والدي في يوم الجزاء السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته السلام عليك يا مولاي يا صاحب العصر والزمان السلام عليك يا خليفة الرحمن ويا شريك القرآن ويا إمام الإنس والجان سيدي عجل الله تعالى فرجك وظهورك وجعلنا من أنصارك وأعوانك جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته.
اللهم صل على محمد.